Thank you. solemnly assure you, if you do not eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you. He who feeds on my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life, and I will raise him up on the last day.
Glory be to you, O Lord. Glory be to you.
Keep me seated. Glory be to Jesus Christ. I just wanted to extend our sorrows from Father Yvonne, Father Michael, and myself to Christopher, Maria, and Christine. We're very, very sorry. You know, this is a time that is supposed to be a great joy, preparation for the coming of Christ. And yet something like this happens, and we pause at this time. There's no other time in the life of a man, I believe, that makes you really take pause at the death of someone you love. I remember when my own grandfather died, and you really start to reflect on what life is about. You think, what are we here for? What is our purpose? And I remember thinking that when he passed away, all of his incredible knowledge, his whole life, passed away with him. I don't have the chance of asking him any more questions. I don't have the chance of learning from him. He was very, very wise, and I think the same thing of Walter. A very, very wise man in so many ways. And we don't have that chance. And so often people think, well, this is the end. It's not the end. This is the beginning for him, as we heard in the epistle. And this is an opportunity for each and every one of us who have gathered here today to really examine our own life. Are we on the right path? Are we doing what God has asked us to do? Are we living the way that is pleasing to our God? Or do we live for ourselves? Really, that's what it comes down to. Many of the great saints often said that you are to contemplate your death every day. Contemplate your death every day. Not in a morbid way, but in a way that helps us to understand if we're on the right path. Are we right with Christ? Because really, so often, we think everyone else's opinion matters in what we do. But Christ, he'd go off to the mountains. He'd go off to the desert. And what did he do? He prayed. And his whole prayer was being right with God. Am I doing what your will, Father? Or am I doing my own will? He never had to ask that because he was so united with God that he always did the will of God, the Father. But we, in our fallen nature, we sometimes get distracted. And this is a time where distractions flee from us. Why? Because it's a time that we really reflect on the life of this person that meant a lot to us. Each and every one of us are gathered here because Walter meant something to me. And we hear that in the readings about the importance of receiving God, receiving Jesus, but just not in any ordinary way, but in a way that is transforming, in a way that changes who we are. Christ said that he is the bread of life. And so many times people think, where does a person go after they have died? What happens to their body? What happens to their being? The thing that made them who they were. And Paul talks about being caught up into the heavens. He didn't know whether he was, where he was, in what level of heaven. Talks about this and the beauty of it all. And eye is not seen and ear is not heard. But you want to know something? God, in his infinite mercy, helps us to understand what awaits us. And so often you start to read that words cannot describe what they experience. They can't describe the beauty of heaven. The color blue, they said, there's not just a single blue. There's over 100, 200 different blues, and each one is so unique and so vivid and so alive that they each have names. And you remember them all. The beauty of heaven, the flowers, as you walk by, they say, for some people who experience this, that they there's a sound with them, and they're all in unison. As you walk by, it's glorifying God. All of heaven glorifies God. And some people I've shared this with and I've read often say, listen, that's what happens when the brain shuts down. You become, you know, the oxygen, your brain is starved of oxygen. No, no, no. It can't be that way. You know why? Because the same experience is seen in other countries. But most of all is this one experience of a woman who was born blind. Her whole life she was blind. And she had a problem with her heart. And while on the operating table, she died. And she heard them say, code blue, code blue. And she rose out of her body and she became overly overwhelmed with fright because she said for the first time, I saw figures. I didn't know what they were. I saw things that I never knew. People would describe colors to me. I had no concept of what a color was because all I saw my entire life was black. So if you can imagine, this would frighten anyone. And I became very, very frightened seeing this. But then I started to realize, oh, this must be what a man's face looks like. Because I saw the doctors and the nurses scrambling. Oh, this is what the hands look like. She marveled at the hand because she could only feel other people's hands or their faces, but not get a concrete concept of what it looked like. It would be very much like if I had to describe to you what smell or fragrance was. And if you never smelt in your entire life any sense of the beauty of particular fragrances, I could talk to you until I'm blue in the face, but you would have no concept of what a scent was, of what a smell smelled like. The smell of a skunk compared to the smell of a perfume, compared to the smell of a flower, or the wood of a tree, or the rain, after the rain has come, is that O2 or O3, I should say, the ozone that's left in the air. All these fragrances, the person would have no concept. And that's exactly like heaven. It is so beyond description that we can't comprehend the beauty of it all. And not everyone who has these experiences are good. Some are downright terrified. But this woman, as she was there, she wound up coming into a presence, as she said, of someone who had such unconditional love for her that the peace and the joy overwhelmed her heart and she was no longer frightened. And that's the same experience people in Africa, in the jungles, in Europe, in China, people who've never heard of Christ, see. And he comes, this brilliant, brilliant light, and rays coming from his hands where holes were. This is from a Tibetan monk who didn't want anything, never knew Christ, but experienced this incredible, overwhelming joy. So you see, you can't say it was just because of the oxygen being deprived in the brain that caused this effect. This is what, God willing, Walter is experiencing. This is what one day, hopefully, each and every one of us will experience, this overwhelming joy. But how do we get there? How do we get there is exactly what the gospel talked about today. If you want to have eternal life, you must eat of my flesh and drink of my blood. In the Eastern Church, we always use perfume. Gospels from St. John. It's called the Bread of Life Discourse. And it's called the Bread of Life Discourse because he talks about what he is willing to do for each and every one of us, that he gives up his very being, his very self, so that we can partake of it and we can become one with him in the most incredible and astounding ways. Jesus says that you must work during the day because there's light, but at night you can no longer work. What's he referring to? In St. John Chrysostom talks about the day that he's referring to, working during the day, is this light. This is the light that we have during the day. Because once the night falls, you can no longer change yourself. You can no longer grow closer to Christ. You can no longer do anything because death has come in. So all that you have at that moment is what you offer Christ. What will our hands be when we come before Christ? Will they be filled with love, compassion, joy, forgiveness, holiness? Or are they filled with material things that we have gained for ourselves? Or memories that are all about ourselves? And the reason I bring this up is because Walter was a man who had many, many talents. And he shared those talents with the people he met, especially with his students. He encouraged so many students over the years, and I felt as if I was one of the students. And many of the students called him a prof, professor. He shared this with me, and it was so true. He was this wise sage that you kind of go to, because he was filled with knowledge. He was filled with caring for the other person. When you spoke with him, he focused on you. He focused on you and what your concerns were. And he taught at St. Nicholas the religion classes, and he was the director there for a while. So I think about him, because I'm the director now. And I hope that I'm doing as well as he did, because I know he encouraged a great number of students. But really, life is all about how we treat others. And do we bring the light of Christ to others, as Walter did? May he rest in peace, and may he continue to do in heaven what he started here on earth. And for those who are still on their path, who are still wondering, what way to go? This is an incredible opportunity to now pray to your Father for help, to pray to your friend, your teacher, your professor, whatever he meant to you, to ask him for his intercession. Because we know that if he's in heaven, the prayers of the righteous, the scripture says, will never go unanswered. So that's why we pray, hopefully he was that righteous. But if he slipped a little bit, God is so merciful that he gives us purgatory. And many people think, oh, purgatory. Where is that in Scripture? It's throughout Scripture, all over the place. But I want you to think of purgatory in a new way, hopefully. Maybe you've not heard this analogy. But purgatory is very much like a person who walks tightrope. And their whole goal is to get to the other side. Their goal is not to fall into the net. The net is purgatory. I've heard people say, oh, if I can just make purgatory, I'll be fine. No, no, no! A man who walks the tightrope isn't trying to fall into the net. He is trying to get to the other side so that he will be safe on the other side, and that's heaven, and that's Christ. That each and every one of us one day will be saved in the presence of our Heavenly Father, our Lord Jesus Christ, and the Holy Spirit. And this is what we should all strive for. Slava Jesu Christu. Glory be to Jesus Christ. The Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
us all say with the whole soul, Lord, whole mind, let us say.
Lord, have mercy.
Almighty Lord God, our fathers, we pray you hear us and have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Have mercy on us, O God, in the greatness of your compassion, we pray you hear us and have mercy.
Thank you.
tu hospodevi. Peace, the holy oblation. and all the saints, again and again it keeps, let us pray for the Lord. Precious gifts which have presented and consecrated, let us pray to the Lord. May send down on us to return as divine grace and the gift of the Holy Spirit. Let us pray.
Lord,
we may be delivered from all tribulation, wrath, and misfortune. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord,
help and save, have mercy, protect us, O God, by your grace.
Lord,
this whole day may be perfect, holy, peaceful, and sinless. Let us ask the Lord.
Lord,
an angel of peace, a faithful God, to guide our souls and bodies. Let us ask the
Lord.
For the forgiveness and remission of our sins and offenses, let us ask the Lord. All that is good and beneficial for our souls and for peace for the world, let us ask the Lord. Of our lives in peace and repentance, let us ask the
Lord.
For Christian and for our lives, one that is peace, unashamed and peaceful, and for a good defense at the awesome tribunal of Christ, let us ask the Lord. Ask for the unity of the faith and for the fellowship of the Holy Spirit. Let us commend ourselves and one another in our whole life to Christ our God.
Thank you.
Since I cannot at this moment receive you sacramentally, come and live spiritually into my heart. I embrace you as if you were already there and unite myself wholly to you. Never allow me to be separated from you. Amen. Just a very quick announcement that if you're Catholic or Orthodox in good standing, you're more than welcome to come up to receive communion. In good standing means that you've been in the confession within the last year. If not, we ask that you would refrain from receiving communion, and if you're of another denomination, because we truly believe Jesus' words, that this is body, blood, soul, and divinity, God himself. So Father will distribute communion, and those who are of another faith, Father will bless you with the communion afterward. Thank you. And when you come forward, if you can just state your name, and keep your tongue in your mouth, and Father will put the precious body and blood into your mouth.
Thank you.
we receive the divine, holy, immaculate, immortal, heavenly, life-giving, awesome mysteries of Christ, let us rightfully give thanks to the Lord. Help and save, have mercy, protect us, O God, by your grace.
Lord, have mercy.
I ask that this whole day may be perfect, holy, peaceful, and sinless. Let us commend ourselves to one another and our whole life to Christ our God.
Sanctify those who trust in you. Save your people and bless your inheritance. Protect the fullness of your church. Sanctify those who love the beauty of your house and glorify them by your divine power. Do not forsake us who hope in you. Grant peace to your world, to your churches, to the priests, to our nation under God, to our government, and to all your people. For all good giving and every perfect gift is from above, coming down from you, the Father of lights, and we give glory, thanks, and worship to you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, now and forever and ever.
Somehow it befitted God's providence for me to honor my fellow service member with a few short words, with three words actually. Grandfather, fairness, and goodbye. A lot of people call God Father. It's our Christian tradition, but I like to think of God as a grandfather. Because grandparents really overestimate their grandchildren. A lot of times I think God has a refrigerator in heaven, just like grandparents have a refrigerator on earth. And often when I visit or bless their homes, they say, look at my grandchild. Look at this beautiful thing they have drawn. And you look at it and you say, well, I'm not on drugs, so I really can't make it out. What is it? Oh, can't you see, Father? And then love begins to speak. So although people may think that our life is a failure, a success, a moderate success, I always believe God has a picture of Walter and of us up in heaven saying, wow, look at my beautiful grandchild stumbling through life. Aren't they wonderful? The early Christians had a saying, life is fair. And I know it's contrary to everything people think and say. Cancer, sickness, death, how can life be fair? Well, the goal of the Christian life is not to have good things happen to you, but for you to become good. You are free to choose anything you like, but not everything you choose will make you free. And at the end of your life, at the end of Walter's life, no matter what happens to you, whether you end up on the cross like Jesus or in the richest house in the world, you will always become the person you have chosen to be. So choose well, because you will never be sad. No, don't say goodbye. But we as Christians say to Walter, we can't go on this journey with you. We believe in the power of God and in the life that you lived, and we forgive you anything and thank you for the good that you gave us. And as Christians, we say, may God go on the journey with you. Goodbye. Please come forward to say your final farewell to Walter, and I will hold the crucifix simply bow to the crucifix and return to your pew for the final farewell.